because we are also involved in fundraising. So we are using that Quranic verses always in our brochures, in our flyers.
Yeah.
When you do something, it'll be double, not double, seven times.
Multiplied, yeah.
Multiplier. So there's a new perspective, alhamdulillah.
Alhamdulillah.
And we like your example of utility. And you said that we can always, that's what all wakaf is all about, is it?
Yeah.
We multiply it. Instead of 10%, we can get 40% if four people are using it, mashallah. So, bro, without further ado, we invite you for the second lecture tonight.
Right.
We receive your PowerPoint, I will distribute to the brothers.
All right, good. Thank you. Okay, bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Alhamdulillah rabbil alamin wassalatu wassalamu ala asrafil anbiya'i wal mursalin wa ala alihi washabbihi ajmain amma ba'du. Praise be to the Almighty God. Salawat and salam let us send to our beloved prophet and messenger, his family and his friends. So brother and sister, alhamdulillah we can get together again and to discuss one of the important instrument in Islam, that is wakaf. Last week, we discussed about the importance of sedekah, which formed the basis why zakat and wakaf is important. So for today's lecture, we will continue from that. But for those of you who joined, who could not join last week, I just want to briefly summarize and review what were we discussing last week, and then I will continue from that. Let me share screen. Okay. Okay. So the beginning lecture of last week, I discussed these things: Islamic, capitalist, socialist, utility concept. For those of you who are in economics, I'm sure you are familiar with the utility. Utility is just a satisfactions, right? So in the case of satisfactions, of course, if you yourself or each of us experience the first class when we are thirsty, of course, we can get the maximum utility. Once the first class finish, how about the second class that we are drinking? Can we get the same satisfactions? No, it will be less than the first one. So let's say it's 8, right? So the total utility is 18. Why? Because the second glass give you 8, right? How about if you finish the second one and you try to add more, you drink the third glass, what utility can you get? Can you get the higher utility than the second glass? Of course not, it will be less. So it will be less than 8. How much is that, let's say? 5, and if you total, then 10 plus 8 plus 5, it becomes 23, right? If you add more, this fourth class, can you get the same utility as the third class? No, you will get less than 5, let's say 2, right? And you get total 25, right? So the example that I give you last week is Ahmad is drinking all four glasses. Right, all four glasses would give Ahmad utility of 25. Right, now, what if behind Ahmad there is another runner, there is another person who is also very thirsty, let's say Umar, and Ahmad give the second glass give to Umar, which is thirsty. How much does the Umar get for the utility? Of course, he get 10. Why? Because Umar is so thirsty, right? Umar is so thirsty, the first class of Umar will be 10, right? What if behind Umar is a Usman? How much utility for the class that Usman drink? Of course, Usman already run for 100 kilometers, no drink, the first class will give him 10 utility, right? And behind Usman, there is Ali. The fourth class that is given by Ahmad to Ali, for Ali, Ali is the first class. And it gives 10 also. Why? Because Ali is also treat this glass as the first class, which gives Ali than utility. Right, now, hold on. Okay, look at this one. Sorry. Number of glass 4 and 4, number of people on the left, Ahmad, is just one person is Ahmad. Utility 25, I cannot see here, 25. And the right one, 4 persons, and then number of persons, four glasses, and total utility 40. And what is on the, of course, number of persons, the right one is better because 4 persons, and number of utility 40 is better than 25. What is on the capitalist? Why capitalist? Because the person who enjoy the resources only one, and he takes all the resources, right? What is on the right? On the right is Islamic economics. Why? Because all the sources is distributed to all the people, to many people, Ahmad, Umar, and Usman, and Ali. And last week we discussed what is the difference between Islamic economics in this context with the socialist economics. Well, if you read the full paper of mine, you will see that the difference lies in the role of Abu as the regulator. If Abu as a regulator give directly to second, third, and fourth persons, then it is socialist, right? Because the role of government in the socialist country is so powerful, right? So the government is managing all the things, right? And in the socialist countries, all the people is treated equally. And how about the Islamic one? In the Islamic bank, knowing that there are 4 glasses in the table, right? After Ahmad get the first drink, the second one is taken by Ahmad and give to Umar. The third glass on the table is taken by Ahmad and give to Usman. The fourth glass on the table is taken by Ahmad to Ali, right? So you see the difference? In the socialist, the one who give is the government, which is in the case is Abu, right? Because Abu is so powerful, right? But in the case of Islamic economics, the one who is giving to other people is the society. And who is that? It is Ahmad, right? Yeah, last week I discussed that in the context of Islamic economics, if all the people, the society, is helping each other, the role of government will be very much less. Do you still remember the story where at the time the Rasulullah was discussing with a sahabat, and it was about to have war, and Rasulullah was asking the sahabat, we need money for the war. And then one sahabat mentioned that I can give half of my wealth. The other sahabat says that I give all, right? So what does it mean? It means that society, right? When the society is contributing, is giving sadaqah, the role of government will be very much less. Same thing, right? Same thing in the context of, later on I'll continue, with what has been written by Professor Murad Sinsaksa. Okay, let me continue with this one. Extravagant. Eat and drink, but do not extravagant. Don't be excessive, right? We are allowed to eat. We are allowed to drink, right? But don't be too much. Don't eat too much, right? It's not only that it is related with our health conditions, but later on, it is related with the price, with the pricing. I'll show you later with the graph, right? Why, if we are too much consumption, right? Then pricing will be unstable, right? Later on, I'll show you. Okay, and then what extravagant means. Extravagant means that knowing that there are four people are thirsty, all are thirsty, and knowing that there are four glasses. So based on the Islamic value, of course, all the resources is given to all the people. That's why extravagant is to its different second, third, and fourth classes. And this is the ayat, which is also important, right? Seven, if we put one seed and it grows seven, and it grows 100, and if you multiply, it's a 700. 700, is it the same with the 7%? No. Why? Because seven, hold on. Okay, let me script so that I can write down. Hold on. 700 percent is not the same with the 700 times. Why? If 700%, right? It means that if you invest one and it becomes seven, that is 700%. But this verse is not referring to 700%. No. It is 700 times, right? 700 times. What does it mean? How much percentage is the 700 times? Right? 700 times. Hold on. Let me, because I want to use my pen stylus. Okay. Hold on. Let me. It works or not. Okay, now it works. So 700% means that if you put one and it becomes seven, it grows seven. This is 700%. But Allah in this ayah is not mentioning 700%. This 700 times. So 700 times is how many percentage? Of course, it becomes 7,000%. Why? Because percent is per 100. Per 100, you delete 20, it becomes 700, 700 times, right? So this is 700 times. Again, 700 times does not mean that if you give 1 ringgit to the poor people, and you wait for your banking account, where is my 700 ringgit from Allah? No, it's not like that. Right, 700 times, it can be in other forms. It can be that you have long-lasting problem and suddenly Allah give you a solution. 700 times means that Allah give you an order, which is Hafiz or Hafizah. That is the form that Allah gives us on the 700 times, right? Okay, let me continue. This is the book which opened my mind, and I learned a lot from this book, and especially from the Prof. Murad Sisaksa, especially when he said that if you develop wakaf very much, right, a reduction and eventually and even an eventual elimination of riba. So Prof. Murad says that if you want to get rid of riba, develop wakaf. Initially, I don't believe on his writing. Right? How come? Riba is related to business, bank, conventional bank, and wakaf is related to social. How come social can destroy business? So I read all this until the end of this chapter. And once I finish reading, then I change. My paradigm is shifting. Then I say, what is writing is very true, right? So last week I was mentioning how I translate this understanding in abstract into an analogy which can be understood by the layman, which can be understood by a normal people, not academicians, not very, you know, doctorate person, just a layman, right? So I keep on thinking, what are the good examples to be really easily understood by the layman? And then I finally got the way to do, and I sent to the Republika and Significancy Wakaf. In this, I give analogy that if you see my drawing last week, the person here is actually the president, right? And that ABC is the people who are sitting, right? A is the people who likes education, B health, and C infrastructure. And these people who are invited by president is fulfilling two criteria, rich and generous, right? So all the people in this room is rich and generous. A would like to help government. Initially, president was mentioning that the national budget now got deficit. It means that the expenditure is higher than the revenue, right? People in A mentioned that Mr. President, for the educational sector, let me bear all the expenses, educations, building schools, laboratory, and so on. We are having so many companies all over the world. I can put as a wakaf in of my shares in that company. And B, in the health sector, also mentioning that Mr. President, I can build all good hospital like in Singapore, Gleneagles, or National University Hospital, as good as that hospital in every city in Indonesia, let's say. And infrastructure, I can build all the roads, ring road Indonesia, let's say, right? So based on the three sector which has been covered by this persons, these people, rich and generous, the deficit, because three sectors has been deleted by Mr. President, right? Education, health, and also the infrastructure. Then initially it was deficit, now becomes surplus. If no one helped government, in the case of deficit, president will borrow from overseas using riba. But if people are helping government, the deficit will become surplus, national budget surplus. The question is, does really Mr. President want to take loan from overseas which based on riba? The answer is no. Why should he? He got a surplus national budget already, right? Why? Because people are helping in the form of wakaf. So people, when they donate wakaf on this kind of sector, right, it helps government so that the government doesn't have to borrow money from overseas, which is based on riba. That's the meaning why Prof. Murad says that if you want to get rid of riba, develop wakaf. Right? Now, this slide is, I didn't have time to discuss this slide, kemerdekaan ekonomi. Sorry, this is in Indonesia, but the meaning in English is the economic independence, right? If you read the date, this is 13 August, right, 2018. I write this in the Republika. Republika is the national newspaper. 13 August means that my writing, this one, is 4 days before Independence Day, which is 17 August of Indonesian Independence Day. Kemerdekaan, Independence Day means kemerdekaan. That's why I write kemerdekaan ekonomi. Why kemerdekaan ekonomi? Because in reality, in the context of Indonesia, right? Are we independent already in the context of economy? Well, I should say not really, right? The initial part of my writing is based on my own experience, right? Based on my own experience. A year before this writing, I was invited by IRTI, IDB, to talk about the Islamic monetary system in Indonesia, in Maldives. You know Maldives? I believe some of you may visit Maldives, but for those who don't know, who heard Maldives and don't know where is Maldives, let me show you. So in this map, it's clearly, you can see this is Malaysia, right? This is Singapore, and this is Jakarta, and this is me, Surabaya here. And Surabaya is in East Java province. Next to East Java province is Bali. You know Bali already, right? So in this map, you cannot see Maldives. Maldives is so tiny country, tiny island. But if you zoom this map, it will come like this. See, it's close to Sri Lanka, and this is small Maldives. Even you cannot see the island, right? Small. If you zoom again, this Maldives, they'll show you this is part of the island, beautiful island, right? If you see this, let me put it bigger. Okay, this is the Velana International Airport. Try to see this airport. See, of course, you know that this is the runway of the, if you, the plane wants to take off, and this is the runway. Look, how long does this runway? See, almost half of the one island. Can you imagine? One island, half of it is the airport. So small, right? And once I leave this airport, the hotel is here, in here. So I should take the boat, speed boat, from this airport and to this island. And this is actually a bridge. At that time, it was not yet. It's still ongoing process in 2017. So when I cross this bridge, I look on the left to the towards this. When I cross by speedboat, I look on the left, looking at this bridge. I see something like this. China-Maldives Everlasting Friendship. So this is exactly in the bridge. China-Maldives Everlasting Friendship. So knowing these writings, then I become, I know that, okay, now I understand. This bridge is funded by loan from China, right? Now, what happened now, right? What happened now, what happened in 2018 when I was writing that paper? Maldives borrow money from China, so much, huge money, huge loan from China. What is the result? Could not pay back the loan. So this is, okay, this is my picture. On the right is the boat, right? On the left is the workshop, right? Okay, this, see the date, September 20, 2020. Maldives could relinquish control of an island as Chinese loan and pressure mounts. Can you imagine? Relinquish control of an island because they could not pay back the loan from China. This is what? This is consequence of riba, consequence of interest. Because Maldives could not pay back, the way to pay back the loan to China is to give a chance to China to control one of the island in Maldives to be controlled by China. So can you imagine, let's say in the context of Indonesia, in Indonesia, there are so many beautiful islands, and one of the island is Bali. Let's say Indonesia borrow from China and could not repay back the loan. This is for example. Hopefully it is not in reality. And then suddenly Indonesia could not pay back. And then we give Bali to China. Of course we don't want it. Of course we do not want it, right? But it happens in Maldives. So Maldives, the neighborhood of Maldives is Sri Lanka. Sri Lanka has the same experience. This story, if you read this story, and I cut and paste this one, Sri Lanka. Sri Lanka had relied heavily on China to construct this amount billion port, right? In this area, country south, after port was operating at a loss and could not generate enough revenue to repay the loan to Beijing, the port was leased to China for 99 years in return for 1.1 billion, which is its positions. So every year, China is giving 1.1 billion. Maybe you say, that's a lot. Maybe yes, but don't you remember that controlling the port by China, China can, you know, can generate much, much more than just 1.1 billion, right? So a port is important for the trading, right? This is the way China, you know, influence other countries by giving loan. And China actually know that this country could not repay back. And then they negotiate how to repay back. And this is one of the ways. In the context of Sri Lanka, the port is leasing to the China for 99 years. In Maldives, maybe one of the islands, a beautiful island that is controlled by China. Right? So this is the damage created by a loan, by riba, right? So how to do? How to destroy riba? This one. A'udhu billahi minasyaitu rajim, bismillahirrahmanirrahim, yamhaqullahu riba, wa yurbis sodakot, right? Allah reduce for usury and increase for charity. Exactly correct what has been said by Prof. Moran. Develop wakaf. If people develop wakaf, if people put some money for hospitals, schools, and so on, no need for government to develop schools and hospital, right? So this is the importance of a wakaf, because it sustains generation to generation. Okay, I quote this one and from these sources to Google, right? Very interesting. The role of wakaf during Ottoman Empire. Try to read this one. Wakaf during Ottoman Empire. A person would have born into a wakaf house, slept in a wakaf bed, ate and drank from wakaf property, read wakaf books, learns in the wakaf schools, received his salary from a wakaf administration, and when he died, put into wakaf coffin and buried in the wakaf cemetery. If you look at this one, it means that from the very, very beginning, baby born until he die, it always interaction with the wakaf very much, right? It does not mention about the hospital. Of course, hospital is already based on wakaf. Right, it does not mention about the company based on wakaf. Of course, it was there. Right, so many role of wakaf in that Ottoman Empire. So wakaf during Ottoman Empire is so significant, right, to develop the civilizations at that time. That's why this kind of instrument is the first that has been destroyed to destroy the empire, right? The wakaf was destroyed to destroy the empire, right? But they learn actually. They learn the significance of wakaf during empire, and they put as the endowment fund. Now we know many schools in US, many university in US is based on endowment fund. They call it endowment fund, right? But I believe that idea is coming from these things, right? This is very nice if we want to promote to raise funds, right? That every single part of our life, education, health, and also economics, has the contributions from the wakaf aspect. Whether it's a wakaf shares, whether it's a wakaf hospital, whether it's a schools, whether it's anything, you name it, right? You name it. That's why when we want to develop wakaf, we need a lot of people. We need a lot of people with a different background, right? Of course, medical doctors also can contribute to the wakaf. Teachers, lecturers, engineer, name it, they can contribute to the development of wakaf. Okay, now we come into the explanations about the wakaf. Wakaf is to hold, to prevent the assets. Basically, it is asset donation in which the value must be preserved and use the manfaat for social purposes, right? To hold and to prevent. That's why it is wrong to say that I give one bottle of one mineral water in a bottle as wakaf to the Dr. Sahran, let's say. It's a wrong statement, right? We cannot treat wakaf in a bottle of mineral water because somebody drink that mineral water finish already. What do you hold? What do you prevent? Nothing. But if I say I have table and I put my table, I treat my table as wakaf to a certain schools, that's correct. Why? That school can use my table, which has been wakaf many times. It's not once, but can use the wakaf many times, right? So the nazir, basically it is asset donation in which the value must be preserved. Must be preserved, this one has to be put in the underline. Because it requires a certain skill, how to preserve. In the context of money, how to preserve the money, right? How to preserve and generate the money. So of course, the nazir, the fund manager who received the cash wakaf, they must know financial management. They must know the portfolio financial management, how to generate money. Because that is his responsible as a nazir, right? And they have to generate the money because the mark of Allah, the people who needs money, the poor people, the yatim, the widow, the grandma, and so on, so many. So many. So the nazir must generate the income so much. It is okay if we want to do business and earn profit. It is okay, right? But it has to be done in the correct way, in the ethical manner, and so on. Once we get profit, and that profit can be used for social purposes, right? So So this is the, again, I put the same ayat as before, right? Okay, this is the hadith of Waqaf. When the son of Adam dies, his act come to an end except for the following three recurring. See, recurring activities must be underlined. Sadaqah jariyah, knowledge that is beneficial, and pious children who pay from him, for him. So if we discuss this hadith, is very important hadith, this one. See, pious children who pay for him, from the parents, right? See, I was reading one of the book by Umar Chapra, one of the legend in Islamic economics, right? He mentioned that if you want to develop the Islamic economics, it has to be started from the very small organizations. And he mentioned family. And that's correct. I agree fully, right? The role of parents in this case is very, very important to educate their children. Not only a general knowledge like math, like science or language, it's not only that, but the foundations of religion has to be put in more attention, right? Foundation of a religion, right? It talk about a submission to God. It talks about tawhid, and also it talks about akhlaq, right? It talks about how to the importance of education. So I agree fully on what his argument that to develop the Islamic economy, it has to be started from the family. And this hadith is in line. Why? Because once the parent has been educating their children in a good way, then the children will give back something to their parents by dua, right? Pious children who pay for him. So the children will pay back what has been given by their parents to the children. The children will pay back by giving dua, right? And this dua is not finished until their parents die. I mean, when their parents die, their children can send, you know, dua, although their parents already die, right? And then the second one is the knowledge that is beneficial. So knowledge that beneficial, this is very, very important, at least for myself. I am a lecturer. Some of you are also a lecturer, right? Of course, we are very, very fortunate that our profession is a lecturer. Why? Because our work, our activities is following this hadith. Because we spread the knowledge. And we believe that our knowledge that we spread to our students is the knowledge that is beneficial, right? But in my case, I'm really so jealous with who? With the teacher in the kindergarten school. Why? Now, those of you who are joining this Zoom, you can read my writing in the monitor, right? And you understand what does it mean. Because you understand, there is a reward to who? To someone who teach you A, B, C so that you can understand. When did your teacher teach you? Maybe you were at that time in kindergarten school at the age of 5. Now, try to calculate your age now minus 5 years old, 5. Let's say some of you may be currently 40 years old and you minus with 5 because at 5 years old, that's the age where you were in kindergarten and your teacher teach you A, B, C, Alif, Ba, Ta, 1, 2, 3. So 40 minus 5 is 35 years. What does it mean? Every day within 35 years, you are reading, right? Of course you are reading. You know, you walk and you read, you understand. You read newspaper, you read books. All you can read and understand. At the very single second that you read, there is a reward to your teacher for 35 years already until now. We don't know whether he's still alive or not, but for sure, he got the reward for 35 years and still continue until the end of the, until Kiamat. Not only until we die, but until Akhirah. Can you imagine? This is what I call as a passive pahala, passive reward. If you come across the business process of multi-level marketing, right, you will come across the jargon like passive income, whereby you just stay at home and you continue looking at your banking account and suddenly it move up, it increase day by day and you do nothing. Why? Because other person is doing the work for you. And that's we call as a passive income. And this is not passive income. This is passive reward. Why? Because at this time, maybe your teacher who teach you Alif Bata, 1, 2, 3, ABC, already died. But his reward comes from you. He is a teacher. I'm also the lecturer. But he teaches very, very foundations of the knowledge, very basic. And you use that basic for daily life. Not like me. I'm not teaching the basic things, right? I'm teaching economics, right? So different. That's why I'm so jealous with the kindergarten teacher. And the last one is sedekah jariyah, right? Sedekah jariyah, and one of it is wakaf. So if you come across an empty land in which there is a banner there, and it states that we need your wakaf, we want to build mosque in this empty land. If you have money, whatever the amount, try to donate as a wakaf. Maybe that's the door of the Jannah for you, right? That's the door of Jannah for you. So sedekah jariyah, once you donate wakaf to build that mosque, and mold is already finished, and people every day, they are praying 5 times a day, there is a reward for you. Not only that, until we die, but until hereafter, until akhir, right? So that's the sedekah jariyah, and that is so important. So about the rukun, now it's 9:40. How much minutes left, Dr. Sahran?
Can take 10 more minutes, Prof.
Okay. I'll be quick. So the pillar donors, okay. Donors legally own property, the asset. So this is the conditions, right, for the wakif. Donor have legal capacity, right? And then property, syariah permissible purposes, of course. So it means that, of course, asset, if you, let's say, person, rich person, but he has a factory which produce the alcoholic beverages. So that kind of shares of that company cannot be used as the wakaf asset. Why? Because they produce something which is not allowed in Islam, right? So asset can be in any form, can be shares, can be anything, as long as the asset can be preserved. Asset has a value, has a perpetual status. Beneficiaries, it has to be mentioned for specific or general. right? In this context, I would suggest if all of you somehow meet with the Waqif, so the right to decide the utilizations of asset is by Waqif. But I would suggest for those of you who meet Waqif, try to persuade him or her who wants to donate as a Waqaf to put that asset in general. Don't specific to, you know, Waqif can say like this, I want to treat my idle land as Waqaf for mosque. That is a right for the Waqif. But what would happen if the location of that idle land is surrounding by masjid, right? So why should he establish a new masjid where close to it is already masjid? So try to persuade him to for the utilizations of the Waqaf put as general as possible, so the Nazir can, you know, can use that idle Waqaf land for anything as long as it is Sharia compliance, right? Expressions, intention must be clear. Waqif need to appoint mutawali and irrevocable. Cannot be taken back by Waqif or ahli waris, right? So if we want to defined Waqaf can be based on timing, permanent or temporary, purpose, family and charity, object, movable or immovable, charity can be a general or specific. The wisdom and the submissions to Allah, continuous reward, and strengthen the unity of Ummah. So this is, I think this is the last slide. This is a picture of Irfan, brother Irfan. My very close friends with his family, right? Why I put this as an important one? Because they are standing in front of well by Usman bin Affan, sumur, well by Usman bin Affan. That well, which is bought by Usman bin Affan from Yahudi, is the water. Was used to as a irrigations for the dates and other the plants, right? In general, income so much, and that income, that profit which is generated, is accumulated in the institutions, and it becomes so big, and then decided to use that amount to build a hotel. You see on the right, if you see on the right behind Irfan, let me give you, see, in this, see, owner, Usman bin Affan. Look at my cursor here, Usman bin Affan. Which Usman bin Affan? No other Usman bin Affan. This is Sahabat by Rasulullah, right? So can you imagine, this is the impact, the positive impact of giving Waqaf. Why? Generation by generation will remember on what you are doing, and they will make dua for you. If you read this one, oh, this is Usman bin Affan. This building is because Usman bin Affan were doing a good deeds at those days. 1400 years ago. So when we read that this has come from Usman bin Affan, it increased our iman. We make dua for Usman bin Affan. And we want to follow his path. We want to follow by, you know, it motivates us to give donation, to give waqaf for our next generation and generations. So that people in generation by generation will make dua for us, right? So this is the importance of our waqaf. Okay, this is the questions which is raised by last week. I just want to highlight and I put the answer here. from Ustazah Halimah Muhammad Ibrahim, I would like to ask if Wakaf is similar to real estate investment trust or REITs in conventional term. Is it permissible to promote REITs as halal investment? My answer is this. REITs is a kind of mutual funds. Islamic REITs is okay. Conventional REITs, we don't know the utilizations of property. If property is used for non-Sharia compliance, of course, it cannot be used as a Wakaf assets. Wakif is not investors, right? Wakif intention is to donate and could not ask for profit for himself, rather for Maqof Alai. REITs can be used as asset for Wakaf, provided that this is Islamic REIT. Islamic REIT, right? Okay, question number two. Professor, currently many countries depend on their economies on increasing level of consumption. Does this situation show that capitalist logic is very dominant in our economic life? Can we apply these rejections of extravagance in Islam to, for example, to solve the problem of plastic waste, for example? Thank you. Well, this extravagance, too much or excessive, right, is directed to human, right? So in this context, this verse is actually referring or is actually asking human not to be excessive, right? So if you talk about the plastic waste, of course, plastic waste is damaging the environment. But that context, right, plastic waste can be replaced by non-plastic. So this is the issue of innovations. People need to innovate to prevent the environment. So I think in the context of plastic waste, it's not really direct to the context of extravagance, right? Eat and drink, but not excessive. Maybe I'll try to explain in maybe next if we have time. Because see, if people eat too much, if people having money and eat here and there, buy here and there and so on, it increase the consumption. If increase the consumption, what will happen? You see the supply and demand. If increase the consumption, it will become like this. The equilibrium price will increase, right? And what is this? This is inflation, right? That's why surat, that verse, eat and drink, but not excessive, is actually to prevent this curve not to move very fast to the right. Yes, it moves very fast because once we eat, people eat and so on, the demand curve will shift to the right. But shift to the right can be fast, can be slow, right? If this is very fast, because of what? Because people are too consumptive. If people are too consumptive, this supply cannot cover the consumption. Supply can increase, yes, but the increase cannot cover the increase of demand. So price still increase, right? So that verse and the human not to be excessive. So hopefully if all people are following Islam, and this curve, if this move to the right, it move very slowly like this, right? So it gives chance to for the supply to move to the right, so that the movement of the supply can cover the movement of the demand, and it decreases the stability of price, right? And then another questions, I want to ask Prof to add more simple way to catching people's minds on the importance of Wakaf in today's conditions of life. My answer is simple, touch the people's heart. Try asking people, let's look up. Try to be less in looking for the rich persons. Because if you look many, many times about the rich person, we will not get empathy to the poor people, right? We will not get empathy to the poor people. And more lockdown, look at the unfortunate people so that it creates our syukur, right? Alhamdulillah, we are not so unfortunate as those people. So it makes sugar, and then it motivates us to donate for those unfortunate people. right? And mix ourselves to bring manfaat to other people. I think this is my last slide. We need Muslim to be practicing Muslim, not just on the ritual only, but strong in economy, being rich, generous, develop foundations for the long-term sustainable development of Ummah. How to develop such compact? My answer is education and Islamic moral value. Education in all aspects. It's not only math, science, and so on. But you see, if you teach our generations math, science only, right, it become like George Soros. You know George Soros? George Soros is very smart in finance. He used, so smart, so he developed finance so much so that other entities is disadvantaged. Other entities is experience losses, right? We don't want to be like that. Education is important, right? But moral value is much more important, right? So this the way, and give example, right? Like Rasulullah is our good example. So I think that is my last slide. And my presentations. Thank you very much. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam. Thank you so much, Prof. Maybe you will touch next week. How about the cash wakaf, Prof? If next week is okay, we can extend it to next week. Yeah.
Cash wakaf, I'll explain next week.
Ah, okay, then, inshallah.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
So there's one question from Brother Nuruddin. If wakaf tends to be general and non-specific, are there any restriction on the use that are possible? The term for benefit of the ummah tend to be very broad and does not rule out the misuse of wakaf.
Okay, my simple question will be like this. Wakaf has a right to choose the nazir. Right. In the context of Indonesia, Nazir can be private or can be public, right? Private, public, they have their own experience in managing their asset wakaf. So try to select or choose the Nazir which has experience, right? Why? Because once they have experience, I believe they will not misuse the wakaf asset. So this is important to really select a good nazir. So yeah, that's my short answer.
Okay, Prof. Thank you so much. I think the example of Sayyidina Osman Wakaf is so classic. And it's amazing to see how it developed until today. And the history behind buying the well also is classic also. It's not just simply buying it. I mean, we're dealing with the Jew during those days, mashallah. So okay, Prof, before we close, any preview for next week or summary for this week?
Okay, I believe for next week I would talk about the cash wakaf and how important it is to develop particularly to the small medium enterprise, because many Muslims are there, right? And we want to help them by giving financing which is based on wakaf, and it can be the rate can be adjusted, right? For those of the Muslim who are not very experienced, a bit high risk, we can adjust the rate of financing rate. And this is, I think, is important for development of the SME. So I hope that all you are here can also join for the next week and also bring friends to join as well. And Brother Dr. Sahran, if you can save the questions which raised in this chat and try to send to me, and I will answer for the next week.
Inshallah. So okay, thank you, Prof. Thank you, Prof. Thank you, everyone. See everyone next week, inshallah.
See you.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.